Tree Books and Harper Audio present No Matter the Distance by Cindy Baldwin, performed by Reena, Dutt. For Megan Murray, James Lawler, Melissa Moore, and every other CF friend who has helped me through the difficult days, and in memory of Christy, with each year our daughters grow, I miss you. Spring Break. Sixth grade. By halfway through the year, I'm used to the changes of sixth grade. No more all-day elementary school classroom with my name taped to a desk. Now, I have a schedule to remember, a locker combination, a different teacher every hour. But some things are just the same as last year, like the way the whole school buzzes with electric energy the day before spring break. The assignment. In English class, Miss Berman gives us the assignment 10 minutes before the final bell. During the last week of school in June, she says, we'll be holding a sixth grade poetry slam. Any sixth grader who wants may submit a poem to the committee, and the winners will have the chance to read their poem at an assembly for the whole sixth grade. Every cell inside me goes quiet, like Miss Berman's words are a cool, clean waterfall across my skin. I can almost hear the whisper of the battered notebook filled with poems I've written, stuffed inside my backpack. The theme for the poetry slam is what I know about myself, Miss Berman says. In your poems, we want you to explore who you are, not just the things anyone can see, but the things that make you, you, deep inside yourself. The deadline for submissions will be 2 weeks after spring break ends. Class dismissed. The room erupts, chairs scraping back against the floor, the flurry of students hurrying out into the April sunshine. But I sit still, glued into my chair by the glittering promise Miss Berman has just laid out in front of me. A poem, my poem, for the whole sixth grade. Blank. Slate. Cricket finds me after class, and we watch for our bus, together, just like always, her backpack full of seventh grade textbooks bumping against her spine. Cricket is pretty much a genius, and so she gets put into all the advanced classes even though she's in sixth grade, just like me. Sometimes, I envy Cricket's brain. How easily it seems to make sense of the world. Mine feels the opposite. Like every day I grow, I only get less clear on what it means to be Penny Rooney. Cricket's known forever what she wants, to work for NASA. Put her great brain to work like Katherine Johnson, the mathematician who charted the course for the rocket that reached the moon. Next to Cricket, I feel like a blank slate, still figuring out where I fit in the puzzle of school, my family, the world, full of people who seem to know exactly what it is that lights them up. Cricket moved in next door in second grade. Her real name is Christine, like her grandma, but her parents call her Cricket for her cheerful chirping chatter. Cricket's mama brought casserole after casserole the year I took all those trips to the hospital, so mama didn't have to cook. We may be different, but we fit together perfectly. Cricket's been my best friend so long, sometimes I don't know where she ends and I begin. Notebook. On the bus, I pull out my poetry notebook, open to a fresh new page, and try to write Miss Berman's poem. What I know about Penny Rooney. These are the things I know about Penny Rooney. Small girl, all bones and points, with brown hair and eyes, black framed glasses that always fall too far down my nose, poems that simmer and seethe under my skin, begging to come out, but never sound quite the way I hoped they would once they're written. Not so good at math. Numbers always tangle in my brain. A girl with lungs that don't always breathe the way they should. Why does it seem like I could write what I know about cricket or what I know about my parents or my sister 100 times better than what I know about myself? My sister. Liana is already home when I get off the bus. Her voice echoes from the music room when I step inside the house. I once heard someone say, "Liana sings like she's given you her whole soul." And she really does. Right now, she's learning a solo from a sad musical, bittersweet and beautiful. The kind of music that wraps its fingers round your heart. If I were to write a poem, what I know about Liana, this music would be first. Banana bread. Mama's at the kitchen table, phone pressed to her ear, calendar pages spread in front of her. Most days, Mama gets home before I do, but getting home isn't the same as getting off work. Mama is a secretary at my old elementary school. Daddy says she runs the place. They'd go under without you, Liz. There's a loaf of banana bread on the counter, the kind Mama makes sometimes, full of so much butter and cream cheese, I need extra digestive enzymes. I cut a slice and sit down at the bar, shake the enzyme pills into my hand. I have to take them every time I eat. Just another part of cystic fibrosis, the disease I've got twisted into the double helix of my DNA. With CF, your pancreas gets all blocked up, so the chemicals that break down your food end up stuck in traffic. Instead, they give you pills made of pig enzymes, which is kind of gross, to help digest everything you eat. High-fat foods need more to break down all that deliciousness. Liana finishes her practice and plops into a chair beside me. "What's up, Buttercup?" she says, bumping her shoulder into mine. Liana is always giving me ridiculous nicknames because when she was a freshman, she took 1 year of French and decided everyone should call each other things like my duck or my sweet bun, the way the French do. You excited for spring break? Yeah, I say, feeling that electric buzz in my fingertips again. I think of telling her about Miss Berman's poem, about the sixth grade poetry slam, and what I know about Penny Rooney, but something stops me. What would Liana say she knows about me? What would Liana say she knows about herself? Maybe everyone else in the world is walking around sure of exactly who they are, deep inside their skin. Maybe I'm the only blank slate girl still wondering where I fit in. The creek. Come on, Liana says when we finished our snack. Let's go swim. Going to the creek, Liana calls to Mama. We'll be back soon. We run upstairs, grab our swimsuits, and in two blinks, we're outside. the whole beautiful spring break world around us. Blue sky stretched overhead, the sharp scent of creek, grass, mud. The lap of water as we run past the kayak shed, and the creek comes into view. "Race you!" Liana shouts, before we're even at the dock, kicking off her flip-flops. By the time she hits the water, I've got my shoes and glasses off. I follow her in, arms arrowing as I dive through the cool water. My brain is clear of anything except stroke, kick, breathe. As I come out of my dive and start to freestyle, I count my breaths. Lift, breathe in. Stroke, blow out. Right, breathe in. Repeat. I think of Mama and all the time she's helped me practice day after day last summer until I could swim fast enough to almost make up for being short and having puny lungs. Even with all that practice, tall Liana, her lungs strong and ordinary, usually wins our races. But today, I get there first, filled with bubbly sunshine. When you are not just a little sister, but a little sister, whose medical chart says things like failure to thrive, beating a big sister just feels good. What we see next. We're halfway back across the creek, not racing now, when Liana grabs my arm, hard enough to pull me under. She drags me back up as I choke and splutter, but doesn't let go. I can feel her feet churning the water so we'll stay afloat. "Pan," she hisses. "Swim back to the dock as quick as you can, but please don't splash." I have no idea what's going on, what made Liana's fingers grip so tight, her voice hiss with nerves. But for maybe the first time ever, I do exactly what she says. We breaststroke back to shore, pull ourselves up onto the dock, skin tingling in the suddenly frigid April air. "Okay," I say, trying to stop my teeth chattering. I put my glasses on, but still can't see whatever it was that made Liana freeze. The moment stretches, thin and tense. But Turtle Creek looks the same as always, calm and wide and lazy, swirling past so slow you hardly see it move. "I saw something," Liana says, still a little shaken. "A fin. Not too far away from where we were." Her words sizzle into me. Nobody I know has ever personally seen a bull shark in our creek. Not here, a mile inland from the Big Noose River. But everyone knows the stories. The fishermen who claim their catch disappeared mid-reel, stolen by a monster from the deep. Or the scientists who came last year to study sharks who swim in brackish rivers and tagged 3 in creeks like ours. Pictures were all over Facebook when that happened, and Mama made us promise to hightail it out of the water if we ever saw something suspicious. But we never have. We wait for a long breath. Then Liana points and waves. "See?" she cries. "Right there! It's gray! Look, in the middle, between our dock and Cricket's." I squint at the denim water, stare so hard my eyes sting. The creek is smooth as glass. And then, suddenly, between one breath and the next, I see it. A pewter dorsal fin slicing up into the chilly springtime air. In my backyard. "Hang on," Liana says, as the fin sinks out of sight. Is that? I keep my eyes trained hard on the place it disappeared. Yeah, I say, knowing what Leon is asking the way sisters sometimes do. It rolled. And almost before I've finished speaking, the dorsal fin is back, catching sun like polished.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.